This video is about initial medical management after a nuclear detonation for patients with radiation injury only. It focuses on determining triage category, medical urgency, and deciding about myeloid cytokine use during an initial medical evaluation. Guidance in this video is based on the Scarce Resources Project, which resulted in 10 peer-reviewed papers published in March 2011 in the journal Disaster Medicine and Public Health Preparedness. The project publications were written by dozens of subject matter experts from HHS and academia. These 10 papers discuss the spectrum of medical responses to a nuclear detonation when medical resources, at least initially, are likely to be very constrained at close-in medical venues. This video is based mostly on publication number 10 by Coleman et al. From the Scarce Resources Project. Links to free copies of all the papers are available on the REM website. This video is intended as a teaching tool and supplement to the Scarce Resources Project publications. The goals of this video are to assist federal, state, and local public health and medical responders who want to understand the initial medical issues after a nuclear detonation and plan for their own response activities in various kinds of medical venues. Victims of a nuclear detonation can have various types of injuries, but this video is only about patients with radiation injury only. Two other videos will be produced in this series based on the Scarce Resources Project publications. The other two videos will provide guidance about early triage of patients who have physical injury and or burns, but no radiation injury, and combined injury, which is radiation plus physical injury and or burns. Neither the 10 papers in the Scarce Resources Project nor this video are official U.S. government policy or documents. The paper's authors and this video's producers are not speaking officially. No products or drugs referenced in this video are being officially endorsed, and this video is represented only as a teaching tool and supplement to the Scarce Resources Project. It is not a clinical mandate or official benchmark for reimbursement or any other purpose. Customization and nuanced clinical judgment are required for optimal patient management. Responders should always refer these complex patients to experts as soon as possible. One of the important factors influencing the management of patients with significant radiation injury is the estimated total accumulated dose to the whole body or significant partial body from external radiation exposure. Doses are usually reported in units of gray, abbreviated as GY, but dose can be reported in other units as well, like rad or rem or sievert. 1 gray equals 100 rad, 100 rem, and 1 sievert. During a large mass casualty incident, especially when resources are constrained, patients in each of the 5 dose groups shown here are likely to be managed differently with respect to the initial triage category and recommendation for myeloid cytokine use. While total dose received is important, clinical signs and symptoms of acute radiation syndrome, ARS, are also important in terms of affecting management. But this ARS management of signs and symptoms is complex and beyond the scope of this video. The REM website provides a great deal of guidance on many details of ARS, including signs and symptoms of ARS. There are many ways to estimate whole body dose from external radiation in a mass casualty radiation incident. Some are more complex and time-consuming than others. After a nuclear detonation, there could be hundreds of thousands of patients or more who require evaluation, triage, and management for radiation injury. With the huge clinical surge, there probably won't be time, at least initially, to perform the kind of detailed, complex, nuanced dose assessment and iterative assessments of signs and symptoms that would be possible in an incident with only a few victims. This slide shows six dose assessment methods that might be useful, at least initially, after a nuclear detonation. Those shown on the left in red font are most likely to be available for the general public early on when resources are most constrained. Number one shown here is geolocation of individual patients. Patient-reported whereabouts over a specific period of time is matched to official radiation dose or radiation dose rate maps prepared and published by the government. Remember that maps will be revised over time as more data become available, and patients may not be able to report their location accurately during the stress of an incident. Method number two is using the clinical symptom of time that vomiting began after the initial radiation exposure began. Since vomiting can result from many causes, this method may not be accurate, but it may be all that's available as an estimation technique for some patients initially. Method number three is to obtain a CBC and use the absolute lymphocyte count, ALC, calculated from the CBC. Using the time exposure began and the time the ALC was drawn employs lymphocyte depletion kinetics to estimate dose. This works because lymphocytes are exquisitely sensitive to radiation immediately, and the speed at which the ALC decreases is highly correlated with dose. Other possible dose evaluation techniques, shown in black, may be available after the initial days of the incident or at locations far away from the detonation. Since severely affected patients will surely be reevaluated regularly, many of the other techniques are likely to be used later on and in venues with robust capabilities. Other information about diagnosis and treatment of acute radiation syndrome are shown on this slide and are available on REM. This map is the kind of tool that could be used for patient geolocation after a nuclear detonation. It was produced for a nuclear detonation exercise by the Department of Energy agency called NARAC, National Atmospheric Release Advisory Center. The epicenter of the detonation is marked with a small purple circle. The colored map displays five fallout clouds, clouds that reflect ground shine. The perimeter line around each cloud has been assigned a dose in rad, estimated to have accumulated over the first 24 hours. Dose inside the line, closer to the epicenter, would be higher. Dose from radiation exposure is highest at the epicenter, and it decreases with increasing distance from the epicenter. The dose clouds have elongated shapes due to the effects of wind. Next to the map is a table with four columns. The colors in the table match the five dose clouds. The dose at the perimeter of each of the five dose clouds corresponds to the dose number underlined in red in the third column of the table. The perimeter line for the yellow cloud connects all points on the surface of the Earth where there was estimated to be 100 rad accumulated at 24 hours. Inside the line, the dose is higher. That's why the table says greater than 100 rad. The light orange line marks the location for all points on Earth that received 150 rad at 24 hours. Inside the line, the dose is higher. That's why the table says greater than 150 rad. Dark orange line, 200 rad. Red line, 300 rad. Brown line, 450 rad. Again, each individual colored dose cloud shows a hypothetical dose from radiation exposure that could have been accumulated on the surface of the Earth if the person had been outdoors at that location for the entire first 24 hours after the detonation. Early official maps like this one, marking dose at 24 hours, are likely to be based on computer modeling data for the incident, not actually measured environmental radiation, which takes much more time to accumulate and process. The table associated with this map gives information about various things important for the medical response. Number one, the colored box column on the left and the description column next to it estimate the percent fatality and injury rates inside each of the five dose clouds. Number two, in the third column, which is labeled RAD extent area, the hypothetical radiation dose at the perimeter line of the dose cloud is noted in units of RAD. It has been underlined in red. That same box in the third column also includes the estimated distance from the epicenter to the farthest point of the dose cloud in kilometers. The third number in the box is the area of that cloud in kilometers squared. The shape and extent of these dose clouds shown here at day one would be expected to change rapidly over time as the radiation levels in the ground shine or fallout decay, and the wind effects change. Maps at 6, 12, 24, and 48 hours would look much different due to these effects. Observation number three is this. The far right column provides three different population estimates. The total population expected to have been inside that perimeter at the time of the detonation, the estimated total number of fatalities inside that dose cloud, and the number of casualties who have not died. It is not clear whether the fatalities are assumed to have been from radiation only or from injuries with and without radiation. It's worth repeating that the doses noted on this map would have been potentially accumulated from ground shine or fallout. A victim would be exposed to ground shine if outside of any building in that area for a full 24 hours after the detonation. It does not take into account any dose shielding that might have occurred due to sheltering in place inside buildings or topographic obstructions. It is the responsibility of government officials and agencies like NARAC from the Department of Energy to generate, update, and share maps like this one with responders and the general public as appropriate. Maps like this one would help healthcare workers in a medical receiving venue estimate dose from exposure for a patient who reports their geolocation for the 24 hours described in this map. While imperfect, dose estimates from maps may be all there is, at least initially, for patient assessment. The second way to estimate dose is by using a tool that is on REM and that was referenced in the Scarce Resources Project papers. It uses information about how much time has elapsed between the time the patient was the first exposed to radiation and the time that person first vomited, if there were vomiting. While the presence or absence of vomiting can be confounded by many things, it may be useful in some patients, especially when there is no other dose data source. This tool is simple and easy to use. Input the date time exposure began, the date time vomiting began, then click Estimate Dose and read the estimated output. It can be downloaded. This tool can be downloaded from REM, so it will be available offline if the internet is not available. Using data from the tool just shown, the Scarce Resources Project created this table for paper number 10. The table can be used with interpolation if the tool just shown is not available. A third way to estimate dose is by using information from a CBC with differential. This allows calculation of the absolute lymphocyte count, ALC. This tool would only be available in a well-equipped medical venue with a blood lab. To use this tool, which is on REM, input the date and time radiation exposure began, the date and time the first CBC was drawn. Note this tool allows up to 3 sequential CBC results, preferably one day apart. Using sequential ALC is more accurate than using only one. Then click Estimate Dose and read the result. This tool can be downloaded from REM, so it will be available offline if the internet access is not available. It is important to remember that there are many other factors besides radiation that can affect the lymphocyte count, but this method is well tested and generally helpful. Other CBC values, including the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio, can also be used to estimate dose, but these techniques are not covered in this video. Using data from the ALC tool just shown, the Scarce Resources Project created this table to estimate dose. If the tool is not available, a table like this can be used. Here is one example. Specify the ALC from the row across the top. Specify how many hours after exposure began that the CBC was drawn from the column on the left. At the crossing of the two data points, read the estimate of whole body dose in units of gray. Some interpolation may be needed when the actual numbers are not listed in the table. The Scarce Resources Project papers deal extensively with triaging radiation injury after a nuclear detonation. This matrix is one of the key products of the Scarce Resources Project, and it is the key slide in this video. It shows how to use dose from exposure, shown on the left, venue capacity and capacity status, shown at the bottom, to assign triage category, which is a proxy for assigning the urgency of care. And it also gives a priority for prescribing myeloid cytokines, which is displayed as a superscript above the triage category. Let's work through one example of a patient thought to have received an estimated 6.5 gray whole body dose. This dose could have been determined by any valid method. Look at the entire row for a dose of 6 to 10 gray. Then assign the capacity of the venue where that patient is being evaluated as fair or poor with crisis standards of care. That patient would be triaged to delayed and not immediate, because of the operational conditions at the venue. If conditions were better, the patient would be immediate. The superscript after delayed, in this case, is 2. which means that the patient would get cytokine, but only after all the patients with a cytokine priority of 1 had been treated. Notice how the operational status of the venue, shown below the colored matrix, affects how a patient would be triaged and treated. A patient estimated to have received 6.5 gray could be triaged as immediate, delayed, or expectant, depending on venue capacity. It is important to emphasize that during normal operations of a medical facility, when there is no crisis with normal staff and no medical surge and adequate supplies, the operational plan is usually to treat the sickest patient first, those who require immediate care. In a huge incident, like after a nuclear detonation, priorities need to change, and the goal becomes to provide the greatest good to the greatest number in an ethical way. That is why the triage category changes based on the adequacy of the venue's assets for the next shift. If the capacity changes for the shift after that due to resupply or whatever reason, the triage strategy changes to match the capacity. This is a very complicated issue with major ethical parameters. It is covered in detail in the 10 Scarce Resources Project publications, including the paper specifically focusing on ethical considerations. To review, here are the definitions of the triage categories. Details are provided in the Scarce Resources Project papers. To review, here are the definitions of the three priorities for using myelocytokines as noted in the Scarce Resources Project. Highest, next, and not indicated. The intricacy of triage, treat, and transport for radiation injury after a nuclear detonation is much more complex than can be fully explained in this video. Senior medical managers at each venue will also need to decide which myeloid cytokine available at that venue will be dispensed to which patient, and if there is not enough drug for all the patients who need it, will the policy for the next shift be to cut standard single dose rations, perhaps in half, for some or all of the individuals until more supplies arrive? These issues are not addressed in this video, but they are covered on RAM and papers from the Scarce Resources Project. This is a complex topic. In more robustly supplied medical venues, decisions about prophylactic or therapeutic antimicrobials for neutropenia with and without fever will also need to be addressed, as will management of the GI, neurovascular, and cutaneous subsyndromes of ARS. These issues are not addressed in this video, but they are covered on REM. Transport is complicated. Those assigned immediate triage are probably the ones needing transport to the most capable medical venues. Also, since radiation signs and symptoms always evolve over time, patients must be reevaluated comprehensively and iteratively wherever they are to note clinical and laboratory status changes that will require new care plans. In addition, at tertiary care facilities that care for the sickest patients, more sophisticated lab tests can be obtained to address dose estimation and treatment. This is a hypothetical map of various kinds of medical venues that would be part of the response to a nuclear detonation. The areas close in and far away from a nuclear detonation have different footprints, staff, assets, and capacities. Some, like tertiary care facilities, have robust capacity and are well stocked with staff, supplies, and space. Other venues, like RTR sites, form spontaneously and have few fixed assets. The specifics of how radiation injury is diagnosed and treated will depend on many things, including where the facility is in relation to the epicenter, how long after the detonation the patient is being seen, the volume of patients entering the facility as medical surge, and the capacity and sophistication of the facility. It's almost impossible to recommend specific algorithms and procedures for all venues at all times. This graphic from Dr. David Weinstock and the Scarce Resources Project shows how capacity and time affect delivery of healthcare. The x-axis is time, starting with the detonation and after. The y-axis reflects capacity on the left and resulting operating standard of care being practiced at that venue on the right. Note the factors that affect the ability to deliver care: distance away from the epicenter, type of facility, and time after detonation. This concludes the radiation-only video. Two other videos are part of this series. One is evaluation and treatment of patients with physical injury and/or burns alone, and the other is combined injury, evaluation and treatment of patients with radiation and physical injury and/or burns. We hope you will share this video with others and consult REM and the Scarce Resources papers to learn more about this important but complex topic.